everybody. Welcome to Cedar Ridge Community Church. My name is Matthew Dyer. I'm the lead pastor here. And I just want to welcome everybody to Betsy's memorial service. We're a really mixed bunch here together, which I think is really fitting for Betsy. We have a lot of people from our Cedar Ridge community present, and we also have many people who used to be part of this church, and just want to particularly welcome you. We have lots of family members, friends. If we added up all the miles people have traveled to be here, it would be a very high number. People come from far and wide. So thank you so much for coming. And just on behalf of our community here, we want to welcome you and say, please make yourself very at home. Before we go any further, let's pray together. Okay, let's join me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we just want to thank you, first of all, for Betsy's life. And Lord, she lived a rich, beautiful life. She really lived. And we're grateful for that. Lord, we are here with great sadness at the loss of Betsy. And Lord, we're also here to celebrate how she enriched our lives. And Lord, I pray you'd help us to do that. Help us to do that in a way that's going to honor her. And likewise, Lord, in a way that will help us heal as we work through this grief together. And we pray that especially for Ian and for Eric, Lord, that you would be with them, even now, as they have so many people around them right now, that this itself would be a healing experience. So be with us, God. We invite you here as we are gathered. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're not one of the people who's going to share in the service, I want to let you know about a few other opportunities that we've created for you to share something about Betsy and share something with Betsy's family. First one is this: we're going to have lunch together afterwards. Everybody's bought some wonderful dishes that we're going to enjoy. And I'd encourage you, deliberately share a story about Betsy with somebody else. Okay, so take some time. Maybe there's something you want to, you know, maybe a humorous story, maybe just a particular memory you have, or just the way Betsy affected you. Share that with somebody else today during the lunchtime. Okay, that would be a great way to honor her. Secondly, we're going to, throughout this service, we have a project going on. In the service, you can go over to one of those tables and write something or draw something on a piece of fabric and just leave it in one of those baskets. There's full instructions over there with the fabric, so just read those. And as I say, we'll take those away at the end, and then we'll turn those into a couple of beautiful quilts. You could also, if you'd like to, do that during the lunchtime. You can also take it away with you and bring it back if you'd rather do that. Okay, so if you want to take a bit more time on it. But we're going to round up all those pieces and make them into two quilts. So that's another way of sharing something this morning or this afternoon. The other thing is we have a couple of tables outside in the Commons area. One of those is to make donations. There are two funds that have been set up, and the information about these funds is on our website and also on Facebook. But there's a fund, a memorial fund for Betsy, and also a fund for Ian. And you can make donations to both of those or one of those by going to that table in the lobby and make your donation today. Or you could look online and make that, you know, send a donation in at another time. And the other thing is we have little pieces of paper on the table next to it where you can write out a story or share a comment or whatever it is. And there's a book to sign in there as well. And then we're going to put those into a book. We're going to, you know, create something out of that. We just thought paper was gave a little bit more flexibility. Individual pieces of paper gave a bit more flexibility for you to be somewhat creative, which was, I think, something that Betsy would really like. So please take advantage of all those opportunities. We have a lot of people to share, so I'm just going to share a couple of things before we go any further. I was Betsy's boss, her pastor, her friend. I experienced Betsy in all kinds of different ways. I think when you're somebody's manager, you know, you have a particularly intense interaction with them. You know, kind of those of you who have been on the receiving end of management or have had the privilege of managing others will know that. And so Betsy and I would have lots of really great conversations. And I, in the 8 years I knew Betsy, knowing her in those capacities meant I got to know her pretty well. You know, she confided in me a lot as a pastor. I mean, we talked through a lot of stuff that we had to do in terms of, you know, running church and particularly putting on Sundays and that kind of thing. Here's three things that struck me about Betsy, and that have always struck me about Betsy. First one is her raw honesty. She was a really honest person. She was very honest about her love for God and her deep connection to God. But she could also, in the middle of the meeting, drop the F-bomb. You know, she was like, anybody else experience that? And I'm like, oh, God, where did that one come from? But it was all Betsy, and it was all real, and there was something beautiful about it as well, if you follow me saying that. So her honesty was stark and beautiful. She also was somebody who, I think she was sort of early 40s when I first got to know her. And people in their 40s and beyond aren't renowned for being really flexible and changing, right? You may notice that. But Betsy was somebody who, in the time I knew her, really grew. And honestly, say that. She worked hard at herself and learning different skills, but also personally, just growing as a person and becoming a more full person. And I just think that takes incredible courage and incredible determination. And you know, that was a really beautiful quality of Betsy. Then the last thing, which I think is the prevailing quality I remember, is that Betsy, and this is no exaggeration, was one of the most loving people I've ever met. And what I mean by that is, didn't matter whether she disagreed with you, and you know, we've got a real mixed bunch of people in the room today, right? And I expect we could all find something we disagreed with Betsy about, okay? But Betsy loved every single one of us. I mean, she had certain opinions about certain things, and I would see her interact with people who had very different opinions about those things. And she had not a bad word to say about them. And she was just an incredibly loving person. And that really, I think, was what washed over all of her life. Love just flowed out of her and it impacted so many people. And that's why we've got so many people in the room right now, right? It's because Betsy impacted us through an incredibly loving spirit. So that's a beautiful thing. So we're going to move on with the service now. And I just want to encourage you also, one last comment. This is going to be a real mixture, right? We're going to cry, we're going to laugh, we're going to have sadness, we're going to have hope. We have, you know, as followers of Jesus, if you're a follower of Jesus here, we have hope in another future, in life everlasting, in a life that's bigger than just the life we're experiencing right now, although it includes that. But even if we don't believe that, maybe that's not something we can relate to, we can have hope that the way Betsy impacted us, the way she loved us, the way the deposit she left in us is going to have ongoing influence, ongoing effect. We can have hope that that lasts and that has meaning and that's significant and that matters. Thank you.
Here's a hopeful prophecy. Through Isaiah, God said to God's people, "Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of God rises over you." See, darkness covers the earth, a thick darkness over all the earth. But the Lord rises above you, and God's glory appears over you.
Tell me when the time we had slipped away. Tomorrow turned to yesterday, and I don't know how. Tell me what can stop this river of tears. It's been building up for years, for this moment now. Here I stand, arms open wide. I've held you close, kept you safe till you could fly. Tell me where the road ahead is gonna bend, and how to harness up the wind, and how to say goodbye. Tell me why does following your dreams take you far away from me, and I knew that it would. Tell me how to fill the space you left behind, and how to laugh instead of cry, and how to say goodbye. Here I stand. I've held you close, kept you safe till you could fly.
Don't throw out the rock collection. It sounds like a personal story, and it's not. But I just am forever finding things in my son's room, and like, this is dirt. Why do we have dirt in our bedroom? Well, it's possible that this clod of dirt is possible, that this rock is possible, that this branch has tremendous spiritual meaning. It's not just a souvenir. It isn't just a cool shape, and it doesn't just remind you of a good afternoon, but it says something to you about God. It embodies the quality of God. And simple people may not have the words to tell you that, especially if they're little kids, or especially if they haven't ever thought about it.
I've known Betsy for close to 20 years here at Cedar Ridge. I'll miss her contagious smile and laugh, her energy that seemed to fill any room she was in, but especially this room, her creativity and vibrancy, her color from the pinks, purples, and blues in her hair to the amazing knitted creations that we've all seen or been blessed to receive. I'll miss how she was a champion of the arts in her life and here at Cedar Ridge, whether it be through drama, music, are all the special elements and experiences she has sprinkled throughout our services and these walls for years. I'll also miss how she challenged me to think of God outside the neat little box I've tried to put him in through the way she lived her life and loved others. Betsy was all about communicating God's love for us in different ways. Let's look at this passage from John, the book of John together, that illustrates God's amazing love. John 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone is coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, "This is the one I spoke about when I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' Out of his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God but the one and only Son, who is himself God, as in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known."
In the winter of 2005, I was recovering from the worst thing that had ever happened to me, an incredibly difficult divorce. And I got to the place where I didn't have a place to live anymore. I had to give up the apartment where I was living because I couldn't pay the rent there anymore. I couldn't find a job doing the vocation that I had been called to, and I was here in this area, living far, far away from my parents, living far, far away from anything that felt like home. And I remember sending out an email to some friends and saying, "Does anybody know where I can stay for a while? I don't have any other place to live." And Betsy called and she said, "Of course." "Of course you will come and stay with us." And so she, and this was when Ian was just a few months old, and she and Eric and Ian took me into their home. And I have never known hospitality like that. It changed my life, and God rescued me through them. And I remember that incredible sense of, here is a place of safety and a place of love. And you all know that Betsy loved to talk, but Betsy loved to listen too, didn't she? And there were times when I just needed to pour out how broken and hurting I was. And Betsy always had ears for that. And there were so many times when it was just hard to get through a day or a week, and Betsy and Eric and Ian would be courage from God to keep on. And one of the things that was most important to me in that season, and still is to stay connected to my daughter and son. And so Betsy and Eric and Ian were like, "Well, of course, when you have visitation with Emily and Michael, they should come and stay here too." And it was amazing how someone who didn't have a home was given a home, and someone whose family was very, very far away found a new family. And someone who desperately needed love found abundant love. And so I just want to testify to that good gift from Jesus through Betsy.
For those who don't know me, my name is Chuck, and I've been honored to know Betsy and Eric for over 30 years. Damn, I'm old. We met on the first day we attended Western Maryland College at the theater department meet and greet. I don't remember the exact date, but it was the fall of 1980. Years later, I was honored to be in their wedding party, and when I was unemployed, Betsy and Eric invited me to live with them. Sensing a theme. And I lived with them until I got back on my feet. And in 2013, I was again honored when Betsy agreed to officiate my wedding. Her opening remarks were pure genius and straight from the heart. And it is my honor to speak to you today. Although I wish it were a more joyous occasion, I'm glad to be here at Cedar Ridge. I know Betsy really loved it here. Back in college, she told me she wanted to be an Episcopal priest. So I was very glad when she fulfilled her goal of serving God and became a minister here. Ministry was her real passion. When she spoke of religion and the Lord, she got that certain earnest tone in her voice that we all know so well. And for Betsy, Christianity wasn't a religion, it was a way of life. You may have heard of Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross and the five stages of grief. One of her stages is anger, and when I first heard the news, I wanted to be angry. But I couldn't find anyone to be angry at. As a Christian, I believe that she is with the Lord now, and so I can't be angry about that. I can't be angry at God, whose ways are beyond my understanding. And I can't be angry at Betsy, because I know she wouldn't leave her family, friends, and church community voluntarily. Denial stuck with me for a while. One of the first things someone asked me was that if it were some kind of horrible joke. And when I spoke with Robin, another college friend, she mentioned thinking that one day she and Betsy would laugh together about the time Facebook mistakenly thought she was dead. Even after that, I kept thinking it couldn't actually be true. But unfortunately, it is true. And I must accept it, no matter how sad it makes me. The world is a different place. That she's no longer in it. I was trying to remember the last time Betsy and I spoke. I know the last time I saw her face to face was on my wedding day. But I got Facebook comfortable. Most days, I knew what Betsy was cooking, what she was knitting, where she was going, or what she thought about things. So I didn't reach out and call her to see what was happening, something that I now regret. So maybe my enlightenment will be one of her legacies. I will try not to be so comfortable, and I will try to reach out to people to see how they are. There are people in this room that I haven't spoken to in literally 30 years. And there's no excuse for that. Maybe you can decide to reach out to people too. Let them know how you've been, ask them how they are, and let them know that they are thought of and loved. It pains me to realize that I will no longer be able to go to Facebook to read her witty comments and to see what creativity her stove or knitting needles have produced. I'm sorry that we'll never know what shocking pink dye looks like in gray hair. Though I doubt we would have ever seen gray hair. But I will always have my memories. I will remember the fun in McDaniel Hall, the summer of Theater on the Hill and midnight runs to the AMP for lines. It wasn't all pretty. Escapades at the Winona on Park Avenue, including 10-cent beer night at Schaefer's Pub. Okay, that was very fun. And then eating French fries at the Buttery. I remember running between the theater and the chapel next door on Western Maryland College's campus on the day of her wedding. She was getting ready in the theater. Places, I yelled, and we still started late. Though it wasn't all her fault. Somebody forgot their shoes. I remember the day many years later when she told me she was expecting, how excited and nervous she was to be expecting. And Ian was such a blessing, and we could all see what a great mom she was. I was reminded earlier this week that as long as Betsy lives in our hearts and our memories, she will never truly be gone. And as I look through the hundreds of posts on Facebook, and as I look at the faces of the many people here, I know that's true. I know that for myself, she will always live in peace of my heart. And right now, my heart is broken, as are so many others in this room. But time will heal. And as the Tin Man said, now I know I've got a heart because it is breaking. On a post in Facebook, Judy Barnett posted the most beautiful and appropriate quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson. To laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate beauty and to find the best in others, to leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition, to know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded. In conclusion, I'll quote from Judy's online tribute to Betsy, which beautifully sums up the impact she made during a lifetime cut far too short. She did laugh often and much. She had the respect of everyone who knew her or knew of her, and she certainly had the affection of children. She appreciated beauty in all its forms and most certainly found the best in everyone she met. She left this world better than she found it, although for those of us left behind, it will be a bit darker. Betsy did more than succeed. She truly lived, and she was amazing.
Well, my name is Bill Duncan, and I'm also on the pastoral team here at Cedar Ridge. And I'm here to lead us in the Lord's Prayer. And before I do, though, I'd just like to share one thing, if I get through it, about Betsy that I've been thinking about a lot this week. And that is that whenever I saw Betsy, whether it was right in front of me or passing through the room somewhere, I just had the sense that something in me smiled. That. I'd like to lead us in this prayer, which is that the Lord gave us, and more than a prayer, a call to life, and let us see it that way. Our Father,
all the songs we chose this morning are ones that were favorites of hers, or meant something very special to her, including some songs written by this community. I was in Nashville and I saw a singer-songwriter that I just fell in love with, and I came back and said, you gotta listen to this song. And She just loved it. And it seems fitting to do it this morning. Some of the songs are heavy, but none of them are sad. They all offer hope, including this one. When your soul's weary, when you find doubt, when you can't hear me, lay your troubles down. In your dark moments, when your heart's weak, bring yourself broken, you will find me. Who wrote the rain?
Wasn't doing that
just to draw attention to herself, she was doing that because she was going to pay you exactly that same respect, that you're somebody special, and it's worth getting to know you. Didn't matter who you were. Christian, Buddhist, atheist, gay, straight, Republican, Democrat, didn't matter. You were treated with respect and love. Beautiful, beautiful thing. I thought about getting a pink magic marker. Also, as others have mentioned, I remember how many staff meetings Betsy would be knitting. And boy, that picture of knitting just is so fitting today, because all of us know we have been knit together. All of us, even if we've never met, in some way, Betsy's life has woven us together. Just walking in this room today and seeing people I haven't seen in 8 years, and we are knit together in a really deep way. And even though any number of things have taken us off in different directions, I think can we acknowledge right now that we know we're all deeply, deeply connected in the ways that count most. And Betsy played a big role in that. You know, in her job, in the years I was here, she had to work with a lot of you who weren't all that easy to work with sometimes. And you know, the amazing thing about Betsy is, I'm not aware of an enemy in life that she had. I just think she could disagree with you and see things differently, and you could, and yet you were still, she never unknit you from the fact. And then the third thing that really hits me, and I wish so much I could have been here for the service earlier this morning for this reason, but Betsy loved the Eucharist. And I think she understood that the table of communion is not only communion with God, but through God it's communion with everyone and everything that God loves. And she knew that, and she believed that. People argue about the meaning of that table. But if you just put all the arguments aside for a minute, you know there's some kind of magic there. Can I use that word? And of course, thinking about Eric and Eric's amazing magic, I take heart that every time we gather around that table, we're connecting with God's deep magic in the world that Betsy wove us all into, and that we are honored to be part of it. Thankful for today.
Hi, my name is Beth Worrell, and I have the joy and fun of having Betsy as my best friend since 1980. I met her in my sophomore year at Western Maryland College, when she was a freshman. Eric and I had met the previous year, and we were dating. Eric and I were hanging out in his dorm room when Betsy just bounced through the door like Tigger. Earlier in the day, she had met Eric at the theater department picnic, and she was interested enough to track him down. Her face lit up when she saw Eric, and then fell when she saw me and realized that I was the girlfriend. Although it was obvious that Betsy had her eye on my boyfriend, I couldn't help but like her. Her earnest, expressive way of speaking, her humor and wit, her vulnerability, and that undefinable something, whether you call it charisma, spunk, or moxie, all of these things just made Betsy irresistible. We became friends immediately. Before too long, Eric and I broke up, but Betsy and I never did. Some people thought that we were an unusual combination. I tend to be a control freak, and among our little group of friends, I have always been considered the normal one. Betsy, of course, was born thinking outside the box and coloring outside the lines. If you are familiar with the cartoon, The Magic School Bus, you'll understand when I compare Betsy to Miss Frizzle, the teacher who led her students on crazy adventures. like the frizz, Betsy taught me to take chances, make mistakes, get messy. Through the years, Betsy has helped me celebrate life, whether we were singing along at a Jimmy Buffett concert, exploring a craft show, or shopping. With Betsy, even an ordinary road trip could become an adventure, because we usually got so wrapped up in our conversation that we'd end up getting lost. Although back in college, we both feared that we'd never find true love, we both did. Betsy was the maid of honor at my wedding and even caught the bouquet. And a few years later, I was happy to see Betsy's magic finally work on Eric. On my way to be a bridesmaid at their wedding, and this may sound familiar from an earlier discussion, I was the one that was so excited and nervous that I forgot my shoes. But instead of being upset, Betsy just laughed that her normally organized and uptight friend could get so flustered, while another bridesmaid scurried off to the chapel to borrow shoes from a wedding guest. And I will never forget the day at the Maryland Sheep and Wool Festival when, somewhere between the spinning wheels and the alpacas, Betsy whispered that she was pregnant. Her face was a combination of joy, surprise, and disbelief, with just a little hint of terror, but mostly joy. And when Ian arrived, healthy and robust, despite what doctors called advanced maternal age, Betsy flourished as a mother. She loved to share the latest photos and funny stories and was proud of Ian's kind heart, good manners, and excellent vocabulary. This week, as I've reflected on this terrible loss, I've stared out at the bleak, snow-covered landscape and thought how the world is a colorless place without Betsy in it. But at the same time, the snow reminds me of one night in college when Betsy and I stayed up all night cramming for exams. We had been drinking tea and taking notos to keep ourselves awake. And around 3 a.m., we looked out the window and were surprised to discover that while we were studying, the campus had been transformed into a snow-covered wonderland. While everyone else slept, we ran outside to play. Betsy in a shiny silver coat that looked like a spacesuit. We made snowmen, threw snowballs, and then decided to make snow angels. We threw ourselves down in the snow over and over, laughing as we flapped our arms and legs, trying to make the perfect angels. Then Betsy said something really funny. I don't remember what it was. I just remembered that I laughed so hard I wet my pants. Which of course made us laugh even more. And we just lay there in the snow, unable to stand up, laughing until the tears streamed down our faces. Now today, unbelievably, we gather in Betsy's honor with tears of sadness mixed among the happy memories. I hope that Eric and Ian and Sandy and all who love Betsy will hold these joyful stories that we share today in their hearts and find comfort. And as we move forward and begin to heal, I hope that you all join me in challenging yourselves to be just a little bit more spontaneous, a little more caring, a little more childlike, and a little more creative to keep Betsy's beautiful spirit alive.
My name is Lucy Provo. It was the summer of 1968. I was 5, she was already 6. I was visiting my grandmother in Sealands Grove, Pennsylvania, and I spent time playing with Betsy Mitchell. Betsy's mom, Barbara, was the owner and editor of the town newspaper, the Sealands Grove Times Tribune. From 1913 until 1944, the paper had been in my family, owned and edited by my great-great aunts and uncles. It was now in the able hands of the Mitchells. We became good friends, Betsy and I, even better friends, when I moved to Seals Grove the following spring. Betsy spoke my language. As the years went by, we shared a love of reading and writing. We'd hatch a plot. She'd write a chapter of the story and read it to me. I'd take it home and add another chapter, and so on. For a little while in elementary school, we shared a weekly column in the Seals Grove Times Tribune called Kids Column. I read one of those columns the other day. My mother had clipped it and tucked it away for me. You gotta love moms. It was silly stuff, really. I reported on an ecology drive, bragging that Miss Giambi's sixth grade class had collected 1,832 pounds of paper. Betsy wrote about a bonfire planned for the high school Shikellamy football game. The bonfire had burned Wednesday night instead of Thursday night, and this dastardly crime had been blamed on Sunbury boys. Betsy shared that the bonfire was rebuilt with much youthful enthusiasm, and that she and I had even donated some lumber. In later years, Betsy took over Carrie Holliday's high school column, Running Amok, when Carrie left for college, and Betsy renamed it the Frumious Bandersnatch, a nod to Lewis Carroll's Jabberwocky in Through the Looking Glass. Beware the Jabberwock, my son, the jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the Jub-Jub bird and shun the Frumious Bandersnatch. In third grade, I was given a copy of Louise Fitzhugh's Harriet the Spy as a gift. I devoured it. Betsy read it. So did our friend Joy Lundberg. Do you know the story? Harriet M. Welsh is a spy. In her notebook, she writes down everything she knows about everyone, even her classmates and her best friends. Then Harriet loses track of her notebook and it ends up in the wrong hands. Before she can stop them, her friends have read the always truthful, sometimes awful things she's written about each of them. Will Harriet find a way to put her life and her friendships back together? The novel became our playbook, our guide. It made such an impression upon us, as did its sequel, The Long Secret. We formed a spy club, bought notebooks, and sneaked around the neighborhood, writing down whatever we observed. Observation, important training for writing and for acting. We painted a room in Joy's basement, and it was our clubhouse. Looking back, there were good lessons to be learned from Harriet. Harriet's nanny, Old Golly, said, "You know what? You're an individual, and that makes people nervous. And it's going to keep making people nervous for the rest of your life." And good friends are one of life's blessings. Don't give them up without a fight. And finally, sometimes you have to lie, but to yourself, you must always tell the truth. Time went on. We were in Brownies, Girl Scouts, 4-H. We trick-or-treated for UNICEF. We did the Croc 10-mile walk. There were birthday parties and sleepovers. Betsy had bunk beds. We spent hours after school exploring the fields beside her house, having picnics, walking along the little stream. Well, I walked. Betsy tended to skip. We lived in a college town, and on crisp fall Saturday afternoons, we liked to go to football games at Susquehanna University. But who has money when you're 10 years old? So Betsy would borrow her parents' press pass, and we'd smile and wave it as we walked through the gates. Brilliant. I know Betsy became a fabulous knitter later in life. I was there when she picked up her first pair of needles. We convinced Iva Jean Shipe, a widow in town who had a yarn shop, and who was the tax collector, to teach us. Ordinarily, Mrs. Shipe taught adult classes, but she took us on. There were maybe four of us, and the goal for each of us was to knit a scarf. Once a week, we'd show up for class in her living room. We learned casting on and then back and forth. Mrs. Scheich would bring out juice and cookies for us while we sat on her couch. Well, Betsy frequently dropped stitches. We'd show her work and there would be big holes in her scarf. But she persevered. It was hard to concentrate, to sit still. Betsy's ball of yarn was a tangle of knots. The scarf was getting dirty. Eventually, we lost interest and moved on to other adventures. I'm so glad that Betsy picked up the needles again as an adult and mastered the art of knitting. As we went on to middle school and high school, Betsy and I started to move in different circles. Her social strata in high school turned out to be, for lack of a better term, the geeks and nerds. Not in the least bad people, nor even unwelcome in our era. Remember, Bill Gates was a child of the 70s too. Betsy's friends were on the chess team, taking the earliest computer classes, locking themselves in someone's basement for marathon games of Dungeons and Dragons. Many in that crowd were the best and the brightest, and in Betsy's case, no one shone more brightly. This gang loved Monty Python's Flying Circus. If someone said "me" in front of her, she was the first to ask for a shrubbery. My final vivid memory of spending time alone with Betsy was from 1978, when we took the bus that ran between Sealands Grove and Sunbury so we could see the newly released movie Animal House at the Strand Theater. Just us, and we loved it. It's perhaps ironic that the last member of the Sealands Grove area class of high school class of 1980 to leave us was Betsy's best friend, David Crow. When David, like Betsy, was stricken suddenly, his mother reached out through a classmate to see if Betsy would be willing to perform his service. No, 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 she insisted. She was too close. She wanted to grieve herself. It took precious little time for the grieving Betsy, the one who we remember, who would do anything for any of us, to say yes. I can't stress enough that for many of us growing up in Sealands Grove, the local newspaper was the cornerstone of the community, and that was Betsy's mom and dad. But anyone who thinks that it was not a family business never knew Betsy and Sandy. We are thankful that the Mitchells, all of them, were there to document our lives. Two of our classmates worked for the paper after Barb and Mitch left us. One of them met his wife directly through the newspaper, and presumably she has forgiven Betsy for that. In high school, Betsy and I wrote for the school newspaper. We worked on the yearbook Cynosure and the literary magazine. We were in class plays and musicals together. The two of us even had a few lines in Bye Bye Birdie. However, Betsy's love of theater went far beyond the class play. She spread her wings to the Valley Players, our community theater group, appearing in several of their productions. She also lent her hand to productions at Susquehanna University, a rare non-collegian welcome to do so. Betsy has always been my touchstone. We've caught up at reunions, never missing a beat. I remember our 10th reunion when she introduced me to Eric as her "what's it?" I was engaged and they were to be married soon after too. The last time I saw her was at our 20th reunion about 13 years ago. She and Eric stopped by briefly. Many of her close friends were in town, not for our event, but for the wedding of a mutual friend the next day. Our Betsy tried to crash the bachelor party. In recent years, we stayed in touch through her blog and the power of Facebook. Again, writing brought us back together. I'll leave you with one last entry from Harriet's notebook. She wrote, "When somebody goes away, there's things you want to tell them. When somebody dies, maybe that's the worst thing. You want to tell them things, that happen after. There are things that I'm going to tell you, Betsy.
I was one of the worship leaders here at Cedar Ridge before Brian left. I just have so many fond memories of meeting with Brian, meeting with Betsy, planning Sunday services, planning music. And even after I met my husband here at Cedar Ridge, and after we moved to Frederick and we moved away and left the church at that time, I would still, every once in a while, come back and lead worship for a service. And Betsy would be on the phone and she'd call and she'd say, "Hey, are you available to come back such and such a time?" And I'd be so excited. And I remember when we did the building campaign for this building that we're in now, and the campaign was called A Place Called Home. And Cedar Ridge will always be a place called home. And I will always remember sitting up here and seeing way back there across that little ledge, that little pink waft of hair, every Sunday that I was here.
Broken heart. My name is Brian Peterson, and I've been the pastor of children and youth here for the last 3.5 years, during which time on staff I've had the opportunity to be inspired by many of the personal qualities that we've been talking about already today. But for the last year, I worked with Betsy very closely in her new role here at Cedar Ridge and in her role in children's ministry, a role that she really embraced and I think thrived in. It was, I think, a fresh outlet for her creativity, for her playfulness, and just the welcoming spirit. She loved the kids, especially the 2 and 3 year olds that she hung out with the most, and they loved her back. I would like to invite you, before you leave today, to walk through or eat in the 3 rooms on this side or 2 rooms on this side. For Betsy took on a project to redesign and add some, as you might guess, some color to our spaces for kids. And that's a project that really she just finished up over the last few weeks. And so I'd encourage you to take a look and see the space that she made for kids. That will just be a part, a small part, of the legacy that Betsy leaves behind here at Cedar Ridge. We are going to read some passages from the scriptures that speak of God's promise and our hope for a better future. And these were texts that held some special meaning for Betsy. I am going to read from Micah chapter 4. And Audra and Liesl Young are going to read from Isaiah chapter 11. In the last days, the mountains of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples and will settle disputes for strong nations far and wide. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Everyone will sit under their own vine and under their own fig tree, and no one will make them afraid. For the Lord Almighty has spoken. All the nations may walk in the name of their gods, but we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever.
The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together. And a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox.
The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea.
And she loved to sing worship songs, and she loved to be a part of a group of people singing worship songs together. And I thought in our honor, we should do a couple of songs that we could all participate in. One that came to mind was written by Brian McLaren, and we're blessed to have him with us today. It's called Lord Every Star. Maybe some of you know it, and if you don't, it's easy to learn. If you are able and interested in doing so, why don't you stand together? Singing is optional, but we'd love to have you join in. Thank you.
RV friends out here in the desert on the West Coast. Picked up a candle lantern in town, a pink one, to match Betsy's pink hair. We each wrote on the paper of the lantern a wish for Eric and Ian and Sandy and Jenny. And Alex and I added memories of the wonderful things that Betsy had given to us. And as we read them all over, we realized the things that we wish for others are the things that Betsy had given us. And we sent this off with love to all of you out east, most especially Eric, Ian, Sandy, and Jenny, and with much love for the memory of Betsy Mitchell Henning.
I'm Sandy Mitchell, as Betsy would always refer to me, even in my 40s, her kid brother. And I must say that even in as much as we had the planning for this service, you know, and Sophie said, oh yeah, potluck for 500, no problem. It is literally overwhelming to my family and my friends and supporters to see these amazing outpouring of love and affection shared in this room. I have been going to funerals much more longer than any usual people my age. I hang out with older people, and I learned a long time ago that if you don't go to your friends' funerals, they won't go to yours. So I've been through way too many funerals for some of my age, but even at the same time, it's still, even as often as I've done for everything from military funerals to funerals for only a scant few people present, nothing even prepares you for this on an emotional level, I must say. The thought that keeps coming to mind is a quotation that of all things comes from a Vita Bailey comic strip with Plato writing graffiti. The greatest treasure of all is to be remembered with love. And if that's the case, Betsy was far richer than she would ever have known. Like any reasonably normal family of the late part of the 20th century, we had the usual sibling rivalry. I mean, because siblings are hardwired to basically call each other bad names, make faces at each other, hit each other at opportune times, invade each other's personal spaces, and so, and let them mock their appearances. Anyway, the big sister. In many ways, Betsy and I were sort of polar opposites in a way. She was a social animal, she was popular in school, extrovert, and I was a loner, an introvert. She liked the rock and pop music. I hold up with classical and folk and jazz music. She went off with a big circle of friends, riding around in cars, going to dances, roller skating parties, beer parties, whatever. I just stuck to long bicycle rides by myself and hanging out with old folks in historical societies. I mean, she was artistic and creative, and I was analytical and scientific. And that tends to be somewhat normal among families in general. I mean, we're like in ways that we didn't care to admit at the time. I mean, in the adolescent age, you know, any relationship to your parents or each other sort of embarrasses you. But at times the differences were so much that at times we just look at each other and just maybe once or twice a year we snap this inside joke. You're adopted, you know. No, you're adopted. Now, anybody who actually knows us really knows that the only reason our parents didn't kill both of us was because we were flesh and blood to both of them. It's obviously the only reason we're alive today. But at the same time, you know, that crack, even just became a teasy acknowledgement that, yeah, okay, we're different, but we're really close. But it was close, and yeah, we're stuck with each other. Sorry about that. After she graduated from high school, she went to Western Maryland College, which isn't actually in Western Maryland, but named after a railroad called Western Maryland, which I'm sure you figured out now why it's called McDaniel College. Wherever the drama queen, she ended up taking up theater. I went to the University of Delaware. She found ways and excuses not to go home for the summer, like internships and theater work, and I did instead. But occasionally we find excuses to meet up with, to go and see her, meet up with each other. And after she graduated, she remained, for some strange reason, down this weird place called Maryland. I stayed home in Sealandsburg with my folks. We kind of many excuses for me to go out and see the big city, that we'll go down and see her. And we trade letters, sometimes lengthy epistles to one another, which always concluded with, "Ha, now it's your turn to write." The death of our parents about a year apart served to draw us much more closer and to depend upon one another, even as she married some friend from college in the meantime. I ended up moving to Maryland for a fresh start, not real why. And for about 6 months, we were even living in opposite ends of the same apartment complex in Laurel. Just brought up above, we could be with each other, but still close, not that. A lot of friends that she made and had at that time would eventually become my friends as well, and many of you are in this room today, decades later. Betsy and Eric, long Christians, set out to find a church in which they would find comfort. Poking around here and there, eventually she would tell me about this church that they started attending, some independent church no one had ever really heard of, where people were seemingly flocking around it, rather charismatic pastor. At least once, I'm sure, I jokingly muttered to a prophet, "You sure this isn't some cult you joined?" Well, if it was, this is a cult that sure surrounded her memory and her family with love today and always. She later would become the technical production director for the church. I use jokingly just that she's a stagehand. It's easier to do that than explain the myriad of stuff she actually did. Some of the stuff I'm not even sure I'm not even know what today. I mean, goodness, they actually started to pay her to work part-time. What was that with that? Eventually, I too would find a romance, and then eventually became a fiancé. One day, somewhere a little over 10 years ago, during one of my visits to her, she sits me down and tells me about this promotion she'd gotten at work, at a job where she would start assuming even more duties and more responsibilities. And even as it turned out, because of what she was responsibility, she would actually get ordained and licensed as a real, honest-to-goodness minister. Not one of these go online, fill out a form, and just send off a check, but actually get a license for a minister. And it's like, the instant response was, "Well, now we know who to marry us at our wedding." She was gobsmacked. She hadn't thought of it, but if I'd hit her in the face with a pie, it would have been more effective. I mean, your jaw hung open. And she just got delirious with glee. She realized, yes, it was true. She wasn't just happy about it and wouldn't feel like, okay, I have to do it. Wild horses could not have dragged anybody else into the job from her. She wasn't just proud about it, she was filled with joy and love at the prospect of the opportunity. So there we are in rural Wisconsin in September 2004. Jenny in her dress and me in my Scottish kilt, Betsy in her freshly made robes. Jenny recited the vows that she had written. And then an inside joke that Jenny and I have been making between each other for weeks. When it was my turn to respond to vows, I simply said, "What she said." Now, Betsy, who had not been in her joke, promptly snapped her service binder shut and hit me with it. And Then she stopped and turned her head to the boat. You were probably in shock. Only my brother could drive. And then she said, now. You're gonna be like, and I tried and whooped out with the real vows I had this point. We never submitted that video to America's Funniest Home Videos, and maybe we should in our honor. I'm fairly sure some of the members of my wife's family were somewhat taken aback at Betsy's exuberance and enthusiasm. But I wasn't. I come to expect this of Betsy. She got anyone who knew her will testify. She was a fountain of irrepressible joy, of optimism, of love, of cheer. A few months later after that, Betsy and Eric would sit me down with a couple of folks in a roundabout way. She asked, they said, she's not going to be having any of your homemade wine tonight. She's expecting. Expecting what? Expecting. Expecting what? You? How? Well, the bee flies into the flower, and then, of course, the joy, once again, Betsy wasn't looking for the nearest thing to hit me with, of course. And later, she even took a little extra effort, I'm guessing. We joked that her due date was coming around December 21st, my birthday. I said, oh no, we're not stealing my day. Thankfully, she cooperated, and Ian was born December 22nd. And once she launched into motherhood, of course, she found a whole new cycle of joy and love in which to immerse herself and contribute to others. Because with Betsy, it was not just enough to live life cheerfully and optimistically. She sent that obligation to infect everybody with which she came into contact with that same charm, with the same happiness, with the love which she had found. They shared that love with the achievement grace and which she had nurtured to overflowing, specifically to share with others in community and life. We're all going to forgive, we're all accused God of taking Betsy away from us too soon. We weren't ready, she wasn't ready, I know that much. None of us were ever ready for this, we can't really know what designs or reasons God had for what had happened. We're not done with her yet, The only comfort that I've actually been able to find, reasonably speaking, in addition to, the greatest treasure to be remembered with love, is that same quote we've heard earlier, which has been attributed to Ralph Waldo Emerson, but the editor, my mother, would be very grateful for me to have done the research to figure out that it's misattributed to Ralph Waldo Emerson and all that, and then supposedly it's been authored by Bessie Anderson Stanley, to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and the affection of children, to earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate beauty, to find the best in others, to leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden path, or a redeemed social condition, to know even one life has breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded. Ha! Now it's your turn to write!
I'm Betsy's kid brother's wife. What he said. Betsy, don't hit me. I'm just gonna miss Betsy's warmth and wisdom and her love and her welcoming me into her family. I was blessed to be able to call her a sister. I'm gonna read Around and Around by John Denver. Time, as I've known it, doesn't take much time to pass by me. Minutes into days, turn into months, turn into years, they hurry by me. Still, I love to see the sun go down and the world go around. Dreams full of promises, hopes for the future, I've had many. Dreams I can't remember now, hopes that I've forgotten, faded memories. Still, I love to see the sun go down and the world go around. And I love to see the morning as it steals across the sky. I love to remember and I love to wonder why. And I hope that I'm around so that I can be there when I die, when I'm gone. I hope that you will think of me in moments when you're happy and you're smiling, and that the thought will comfort you on cold and cloudy days if you are crying, and that you'll love to see the sun go down and the world go around and around and around. Thank you all so much for your support and love.
It began for me in September of 1980, exactly 33 and a third years ago. Yes, let's pause and cherish the irony of that. 33 and a third years ago, it was the drama department picnic, and I was a sophomore, and I decided to go check out the fresh meat, the new students that were coming in, and I was not a very nice person in college, just ask Beth. There were a lot of really cool people there. They all seemed so young, and I'd only been in college for a year, but they all seemed so young to me. And I remember meeting Chuck, and I met a few other people. And then I saw this young lady, wide-eyed country girl, happened to be wearing a Monty Python Flying Circus t-shirt. Those of you who don't know the story thus far, Monty Python Flying Circus was a comedy sketch show on the BBC. It was done in the late 1960s and then magically somehow managed to find its way onto public television in the U.S. in the early 1970s. And so our relationship began, so many things have, with me walking up to her and saying, "Are those sheep up in the trees?"
Are you on a holiday or? No. What are you doing? Oh, it's only good. there's a lot of sheep on it. It's called the water. why are they up in the trees? A fair question, and one that in recent weeks has been put on my mind. It's my considered opinion that they're nested. Like birds. Exactly. Birds is the key to the old problem. It's my belief that these sheep are laboring under the misapprehension that they're birds. Observe their behavior. Take for a start the sheep's tendency to walk about the field on their back legs. Bear witness their attempts to fly from tree to tree. Notice they do not so much fly as plummet. Observe, for example, that ewe in that oak tree. He is clearly trying to teach your lamb to fly. Talking about the blind leading the blind. It does. Another fair question. One thing is for sure, a sheep is not a creature of the air.
It has great comparative difficulty in the relatively simple act of perching. Yes, so we did the entire sketch verbatim, and I knew that I had found a kindred spirit, and then later I discovered it was a soulmate. It was much later, actually, because although there was undeniable chemistry there, she actually spent our entire college career, most of it, engaged to a guy that she literally met 5 minutes before she met me. He might actually be here today. Chris, are you here? Okay. Wonderful guy, Chris Murphy. Anyway, so we didn't date in college. We were best friends. We told each other everything. We told each other our boy problems and girl problems. She stage managed the first play I ever directed. And we continued that way, and it was great. And then graduation came, and then I would come up and visit during her senior year. And then she graduated and moved to Baltimore with Beth. and, you know, dodging the bullets. And eventually ended up in Hinesville. And we kind of drifted apart. We kind of lost contact. And then there's the sort of dark period of the Dark Ages that I call, which was my training wife. You can always tell the training wife by little wheels on the back. And so it was literally about 3 or 4 days after she had kicked me out and started divorce proceedings that Betsy suddenly called me up on the phone and said, "Hey, I'm having a, we're moving out of our apartment. Dorney and I are moving out of our apartment. We're moving to a different place. We've already cleaned up everything. You want to come and hang out?" And I was like, great, because I wasn't allowed to talk to any of my old female friends from before until then. So I said, great, let's get together. And I went over to her old place, which was empty except for a really big box of wine and a lot of plastic cups. And then I said, I've got to go. And then we sat in my car and we did that thing that we had done in college so many times, which is we had the talk where we sat up most of the night and just talked, and everything came out. And I knew we would be hanging out, and I knew we'd be friends, but I was feeling terribly guilty because I didn't realize, it turns out that my divorce was already final, but I did get the papers in the mail for like a year. So I'm sitting there, and so we were friends. We're friends. Meanwhile, all of our friends are like having a pool to see, you know, to see what date we're gonna get engaged on and when we're gonna get married. And I think Dorney won a pool, actually. And then her mom got sick. Her mom had a stroke and was in a coma for 9 months. And we spent 9 months shuttling back and forth between Laurel and Selinsgrove, Grove, Pennsylvania, and the hospital and everything like that every weekend. And I would do my radio show from the manager's office at the Shoney's in Enola, Pennsylvania, on the way up every Saturday morning. And it was poor Ralph was trying to work the board with the long distance car. It was crazy. And those three and a half hours each way, in case you're counting. And again, when you have just started dating somebody and you get to sit in a car with them during a crisis for 7 hours every weekend, you get to know each other really, really well. And so that really helped build a relationship. The other thing that helped was her dad, who, with, as you might have guessed, the lack of boundaries common in the Mitchell family, constantly referred to me as her boyfriend, even while she was engaged to Chris. Now, because parents know a thing, I've come to realize that. Parents know something. See, he met me at the end of Betsy's freshman year when, like all freshmen do, she suddenly realized exams are over, my dad's almost here, he's gonna be here in an hour to pick me up with the Pinto. And I've got a room that's packed floor ceiling with stuff that's accumulated all year. And so we're stuffing into trash bags and we're getting in the back. And I found out later that all the way home to Selinsgrove, mind you, she's engaged to Chris at this time. All the way home, her dad's going, "That Henning boy's got a good strong handshake. I like him. He's really interested." And he kept asking her about me. She'd be like, "Daddy, what is going on?" And then later, when we started getting back together, her parents came down from Selinsgrove to visit her in Laurel, and we all went out to lunch together in College Park. And I, at that time, and we'll get to another part of the story, but at that time I was super, super right-wing Republican, evangelical Christian boy working on the Pat Robertson campaign and everything. And her dad was somewhere to the right of that. And so we got along really, really well. Really well. And we're talking, and I went to the bathroom, and he turns to Betsy and says, "I didn't think you were going to marry your father." Something else happened during college that's important. And the thing that's happened was that in the midst of my thinking that I was going to cut quite a swath through the Western Maryland college female population, God decided to hit me upside the head with a 2x4 And I had a really dramatic dream experience that I won't go into details here, but suffice it to say, you don't want to have this experience. If you're really good at listening to God and you hear that still small voice, really listen. Because if he has to hit you upside the head because you're not paying attention, it's not fun. And so I became a Christian, and I wasn't a very nice person to begin with, and so now I became not a very nice Christian. But it's a stage that everybody goes through. Everybody goes through this stage where I want to make sure I got all the T's crossed and all the I's dotted so that I've got everything right, and if you disagree with me about one of those little pieces of punctuation, then you're going straight to hell. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Everybody goes through this. It's a developmental phase. And Betsy hung with me. God bless her. And a few others of you that are here today, Megan and Chuck and folks at Beth, hung with me in those times and said, you know, there's something else in there. We know it. Hello? Eric, are you in there? And I remember there was a time, and Betsy, and the only reason I mention this is because it seemed like an important moment for Betsy. We were sitting on the floor of my dorm room, and which was a room in a house, actually, on campus, Chandler. And I was talking about what I was learning in the Bible, and I was talking about the end times and what I kind of thought it meant. And I got up to go to the bathroom, and I came back, and Betsy was flat on the face, on her face on the floor. And she told me later that when I left, she had just felt this presence, this voice of God, and she bent over to pray, and she just felt like this weight pressing her down to the floor, and God saying, listen to this, this is important. You need to pay attention. And she renewed her faith in Christ at that point and took off in a completely different angle, thank God, because she kind of pulled me along with her, and we kind of met in the middle. And that was fuel for a lot of discussions and a lot of interesting stuff that happened later on. A long time later, then her mom died, and then right after that we got engaged. Her dad lived long enough to see us married, and then it was yet another trip up to Zealand's Grove to deal with people who thought they were immortal, so they didn't have wills. Do something about that yourself, if you would. And then our marriage was weird because we didn't fight. And everybody I knew fought, and then made up. We didn't really fight. We agreed on pretty much everything because we were such good friends. We'd been friends for so long before we got married that it just seemed like a very natural transition. And then we hit the wall. It's what I call a gifted child problem. The longer it takes you to fail at something, the harder it is when it happens. And in the spring of 2005, we hit the wall in our relationship. We got through a really rocky patch, and we finally learned how to fight. 9 months later, we had Ian. And I'll bet if you talk to your parents, you're gonna hear the same story most of the time. So whenever Ian gives me this look like, I'm a pirate, I remember that, because I think I know where it came from. I remember we went to the first sonogram, and of course, Betsy, okay, first of all, if you're over 40 and you get pregnant, don't go on the internet and look up 43-year-old mom, because you'll just get scared out of your wits. And thank God we had our friends at Cedar Ridge, because we have so many people. I remember so many people, Shova, and a lot of people who are in the profession, in medical medicine, and Falami, and Madiwa, and a lot of people who helped us. And they're like, Shova's hilarious. She was like, 43, we got 60-year-old moms. We worry about that. 43's nothing. So we dealt with it. But the first sonogram, by the way, we knew. As soon as she got pregnant, I knew it was a boy. And she was kind of arguing with me, like, is it a boy? How do you know it's a boy? I don't know. I'm like, it's a boy, trust me. And the first sonogram, honest to God, here's what we saw. Ian's in there doing a little buck and wing. And we came to Cedar Ridge 20 years ago, in the spring of 1994. I remember because Dave Wilcox had a new album out, and we were listening to an interview with Dave Wilcox on PBS as we were driving to church. Ralph Thomas, my sound operator at WCTN, had said, oh, there's this church that would be perfect for you guys. We were kind of in between churches. We were worshiping at the, you know, at the Shrine of the New York Times every Sunday. And so we went into this, we went over to Capital College, and what we saw was remarkable. What we saw was people who had been drunk in an alley the night before, sobered up, serving donuts and bagels. We saw people who would not be welcome in most churches because they didn't vote the right way, hold the right doctrine, love the right people, or wear the right clothes. Or maybe they had too many tattoos. And they had people who were coming in and they were not just welcome, they got put to work. And this was very exciting for us. And so we became a part of them. Through that, this land was purchased, and some of you know the story and the miracle of that, and this building was built. And so this church is really a huge part of our life. In some ways, it was Betsy's first and oldest child. And so when one morning, I would sleep in a little bit. She would have to get up at like some ungodly hour. I don't know what time you guys set up in here. It's like 5 in the morning, 6 in the morning for Sunday services. And she would get up, and I'm like, no, I usually had a show the night before because I can't come to her. Right after Ian was born, I came to her and I said, how would you feel about me quitting the financial business? And I was a partner in a money management firm at the time. How would you feel about me quitting that business and going to Magic full time? And she said, oh my God, I've been waiting 5 years to hear you say that. But that was Betsy, you see. Betsy was somebody who always gave you permission to be yourself, to be who you were, to be who you are. And you could be more yourself with her than with anybody else. That's what she did. That's what she did for me. Our whole time together, in some ways that I'm only now beginning to appreciate. And so one morning, she was about 6 months pregnant. I came in later, before the second service, and she grabs me and she hustles me down the hall into Brian's office. And she said, and she's got tears coming out of her face. She says, I haven't felt the baby move since yesterday afternoon. And she was just terrified. And I said, okay. I'll tell you what, I read somewhere that they can hear things while they're in utero. They can hear outside things, people play music. So I leaned over and I said, hey, in an act, by the way, that would be repeated endlessly over the next 8 years. Hey, time to get up, wake up. Come on, let's go. And he started kicking. He knew my voice. And the first thing, and when he came out in a scene, a birthing scene that could have been choreographed by the Three Stooges. No, I'm serious. Doctors pulling on things, flying across the room. I was like, stuff coming out. I'm like, don't throw away anything. There's office furniture. Save everything. Clean everything off. Don't lose anything, please. They found the baby, and they do that thing that they do, which is really frightening. If you've ever been in the room when somebody's been born, they take the baby off to a corner to make sure it's breathing, it's alive, it's not diabetic, and they don't want you to see it until they've done the checklist, just in case there's something you don't want to see. And I'm sitting there talking, and they're asking me, what's the name going to be? And I started talking, and his head just snapped around. He heard my voice, he recognized me. His middle name, Miller, is after a couple who became surrogate grandparents to me in my life, and also his grandmother's, we never knew him, his grandmother's maiden name. It was a convenient coincidence. He knew my voice, and that reminded me of Betsy. Betsy knew God's voice. Betsy snapped her head around every time she heard God, and I guess the thing that I want to tell you most of all is, if we left here today thinking, what a great person, what an extraordinary person Betsy was, and she was, and how much she touched our lives, and she did, and how unique that is, if that's where it ended, that would be a terrible tragedy. That would be just an awful tragedy. Because you see, everything you love about Betsy, everything that you cherish about her, everything that made you feel special, Everything, every time she loved you, every person that she only knew on Facebook. I would come home from a gig and it'd be midnight, she'd be still up knitting. And I'd say, what happened? She said, well, one of my Facebook friends having a rough time. I'm gonna make her a hat and send it there. Because she couldn't hug her in person. So she would send her a portable hug. Everything you love about Betsy and all the stories you're gonna share in a few minutes, they all came from the fact that she was not an extraordinary person. She was an ordinary person with an extraordinary commitment to Jesus Christ. She was an ordinary person whose only goal in life was to be a conduit for God's love and blessing in other people's lives. And it would be a horrible tragedy if you thought that that was unique to Betsy. Because if there is one thing that I know she would want you to know now, it is that you and I and everyone here can be just as extraordinary if we will not hoard God's love to ourselves, but let it out. You can be the person that people, when you sit in the metro rail, people come up and sit next to you and in 20 minutes tell you their entire life story. Complete strangers. It happened all the time. I just would stare at her going, oh my God, how did you not become a minister? And she wanted to go to seminary. She wanted to get ordained. She already had her flock. She already had her church. She already had her ministry. And she had the last laugh because this wonderful, completely spherical, pink-haired person, she knew that sheep really can't fly. And so now it's time for you to fly. I'm going to do the benediction. Whenever there's a special occasion, I like to bring a bottle of the bubbly. And for those of you on the program, you can relax. It's not actually champagne. It's actually bubbly. It reminds me of summertime when I was a kid, probably when you were kids too, when mom would get out the bubble juice, the soap, and we'd play, because the humidity around here had to be good for something. But what's the first thing you learn when you're a kid about bubbles? The first thing you learn is they don't last very long. And then when you're a few years older, you realize neither did those summers. And now I'm at an age where I'm beginning to realize neither do people. Bubbles and people, don't you wish they both lasted longer? So my wish for you, for all of us, today and every day, as we go forward from this place, carrying whatever piece of Betsy we have with us, and hopefully translating that into a greater connection to Jesus himself. Take those moments, those special times, and grab a hold of them, and hold fast, and keep them as long as you possibly can. Thank you so much for your care, your outpouring of affection to me and my family. Thank you to all the musicians who did such a wonderful job and everybody who participated today, and all of you. I may not get a chance to thank you all individually, but please know how much this has meant to us. Thank you. Now, go in God's love, go in God's peace.
Thanks be to God.